Welcome to new video of PharmaTrioxx. Today we are going to discuss some important GPAT previous questions from pharmaceutics. Moving on to first question. Relative sweetness of sucrose to saccharin. Option A 1:200. Option B 1:500. Option C 1:100. And option D 1:400. Here the correct answer is option B 1:500. So we are going to discuss in detail regarding this question. Saccharin, which was discovered by Remsen and Fahlberg in 1879, and it is an oldest artificial sweetener. It is 200 to 700 times sweeter than sucrose, and it's available in liquid and tablet forms as a tabletop sweetener. And it has some disadvantage, like it is bitter aftertaste. And the major disadvantage for saccharin is it is carcinogenic, and so that it is not widely used in pharmaceutical formulations. Another artificial sweetener, which is aspartame, it has a disadvantage of it lacks the stability in presence of moisture. So this is an explanation for the mentioned question. Moving on to second question. Type 2 glass containers are option A, they are suitable for alkaline solutions. Option B, most inert glasses and shows high hydrolytic resistance. Option C, suitable for most acidic and neutral aqueous preparations. And option D, they are suitable for non-aqueous preparations. Here the correct answer is option C, which is suitable for most acidic and neutral aqueous preparations. So we can explain this question, which will be usable for your exams. So the term parenteral, which is derived from Greek word para, which means beside, and enteron means intestine. Okay, other than intestine. So here we are explaining four types of glasses. Type 1, which is highly resistant and borosilicate glasses. The test which is used to identify type 1 glass is powdered glass test, and they are used in buffered and unbuffered aqueous solutions. Type 2, which are treated soda lime glass, they are used to identify by using water attack test and used for buffered aqueous solutions with below pH 7. In case of type 3 glasses, they are soda lime glass, and the test used to identify is powdered glass test, and they are used to store dry powders and oleaginous solutions. And type 4 or non-parenteral glasses, they are general purpose soda lime glass. Powdered glass test is used for the identification of non-parenteral type glasses. So as the name indicates, it is not for parenterals and used for the storage of tablet, suspension and capsules. Moving on to third question. Dimethyl sulfoxide, it acts as a penetration enhancer for topical formulations by option A, by increasing solubility. Option B, denaturing proteins. Option C, increasing transepidermal loss. And option D, altering solvent nature of the membrane. So here the question is, what is the mechanism of dimethyl sulfoxide as a penetration enhancer? So the answer is it acts by denaturing the proteins. So here we have to explain what is dimethyl sulfoxide. Okay, we have to know what is dimethyl sulfoxide. So moving to its explanation, dimethyl sulfoxide, it is an amphiphilic molecule. What do you mean by amphiphilic molecule? It consists of both hydrophilic sulfoxide group and will contain hydrophobic group. Okay, a molecule which contain both hydrophilic and hydrophobic group, it can be called as amphiphilic molecule. This amphiphilic nature is central to the interaction. Okay, it is the reason for the interaction between DMSO, that is dimethyl sulfoxide, and cell membrane, and hence the dimethyl sulfoxide efficiency as a penetration enhancer. Dimethyl sulfoxide is capable for enhancing the permeation of both hydrophobic and hydrophilic molecules across the cell membrane. So this is the explanation for dimethyl sulfoxide. Next question. Violin gut is obtained from the intestine of option A, horse, option B, cat, option C, sheep, and finally option D is camel. The answer is option C, sheep. So what is violin gut? Okay, violin gut, it is absorbable sutures prepared from the intestine of sheep. The name is derived from the word kit, gut, which means small violin. So cat guts are of two types. They are biolabile cat guts and non-biolabile cat guts. So biolabile cat guts, if tubing is anhydrous, then it is called as biolabile, and if the tubing contains alcohol and small water, so which avoids heat sterilization, is non-biolabile. Okay, these are the two type of cat guts which are used as disposable materials or suturing materials. Moving on to next question. Pyrogens present in containers can be destroyed by heating the containers at option A 121 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes, option B 121 degrees Celsius for 30 minutes, option C 210 degrees Celsius for 4 hours, and option D 210 degrees Celsius for 1 hour. And the correct answer is 210 degrees Celsius for 4 hours, that is option C. Okay, it's an important question. It may ask in your coming exam also. So moving on to its explanation, pyrogens, the word pyrogen, the pyro means Greek, which is fire, and gen, the Greek word, which means beginning. So pyrogens are fever producing metabolic byproducts of microbial growth and death. So bacterial pyrogens are called endotoxins. Normally gram negative bacteria produce more potent endotoxins than gram positive bacteria and fungi. Don't forget it. Gram negative bacteria will produce more potent endotoxins than gram positive. So endotoxins are heat stable lipopolysaccharides, and they are present in cell walls, and they are not present in cell free bacteria. Okay, this is about the explanation for pyrogens. Moving on to sixth question. In capsule making, the bloom strength of gelatin is proportional to the molecular weight of gelatin and is a measure of option A, cohesive strength of the solvent molecules, option B, cohesive strength of the cross-linking that occurs between gelatin molecules, option C, adhesive strength of gelatin with dipping pins, and finally option D, adhesive strength of gelatin with other polymer. Here the answer is option B, cohesive strength of the cross-linking that occurs between gelatin molecules. So we have to understand what you mean by bloom strength. Bloom strength, it is a test that is used to measure the strength of a gel or gelatin which can be used in capsule preparation. To test it needs the weight in grams needed by specified plunger to depress the surface of the gel at specified temperature 4 millimeter without breaking the gel. So the result is explained in Bloom's. Okay, Bloom strength normally which ranges from 150 to 280 gram. Don't forget it, Bloom strength, it ranges from 150 to 280 gram and are considered for capsules. So the higher the Bloom strength, the stiffer the gel, and it is measured by using Bloom gelometer. Don't forget it, it measured by using Bloom gelometer. Moving to seventh question. So here the question is, choose the wrong statement from the following with regard amorphous solids. Option A, they are usually anisotropic. Option B, they tend to follow flow when subjected to sufficient pressure. Option C, considered as supercooled fluids. And option D, they do not have definite melting point. Here the correct answer is option A, usually they are anisotropic. Okay, it is the wrong statement regarding amorphous solids. So here we are going to discuss some important difference between crystalline solids and amorphous solids. Crystalline solids have geometrical shape and amorphous solids will not have, and crystalline solids have sharpening melting point but amorphous solids will not have. Then the physical properties of crystalline solids are different in different directions, and this phenomenon is known as anisotropy. And in case of amorphous solid, physical properties of amorphous solids are same in different directions and amorphous solids are known as isotropic. When crystalline solids are rotated about an axis, their appearance does not change. Okay, this shows they are symmetrical. And in case of amorphous solids, they are unsymmetrical. And also finally, crystalline solids cleavage along particular direction at fixed cleavage planes, and in case of amorphous solids, they don't break at fixed cleavage planes. Moving on to eighth question, the crenulation effect on the cell is caused by dash solutions, and this effect is called dash. Option A, hypertonic and reversible. Option B, hypotonic, reversible. Option C, hypotonic, irreversible. Option D, hypertonic, irreversible. So the crenulation effect is caused by option A, hypertonic, and the solution and this effect is called reversible. Moving on to its explanation, Okay, isotonic solution means it is a solution having the same osmotic pressure as a body fluid. Okay, the solution which is having same osmotic pressure to our body fluid, it is called as isotonic solution. Normally, ophthalmic, nasal and parenteral solutions should be isotonic. Okay, rather than isotonicity, there are two more conditions which are hypertonic and hypotonic. Okay, if a hypertonic solution, that is higher osmotic pressure than body fluid, administered intravenously, then the water is drawn from the cells and causing them to shrink. Okay, it is also called as crenulation. In case of hypotonic, what will happen? In case of hypotonic solutions administered intravenously, water will enter into the RBC and causing them to swell and it may burst. Okay, so there may be hemolysis can be happened. So crenulation or crenation, which happens in hypertonic solutions, and hemolysis will happening in hypotonic solution. Okay, don't forget it. It's an important question. Moving on to 9th question. In solid-solid mixing, large scale continuous type of mixer is option A, sigma blender, option B, ribbon blender, option C, zigzag blender, and option D, twin shell blender. And here the answer is option C, zigzag blender. Moving on to its explanation, here we have demonstrated its structure. The principle is material undergoes tumbling motion. Don't forget it. In zigzag continuous blender, what is the motion? Tumbling motion is happening. And about its construction, it consists of a long shell, we can see in that picture, which takes the shape of several V-shaped web blenders. Okay, it is the shape, it is the construction and principle behind our instrument. Moving on to 10th question, shape well label must be placed on the containers of option A, ophthalmic suspension, option B, occlusive, option C, ophthalmic solution, and option D, ophthalmic gels. Here the correct answer is ophthalmic suspensions. We can explain this question. So occlusives are stored in, okay, what is the condition for occlusive? It can be stored in refrigerator, discard, contaminated or damaged disc. In case of ophthalmic solution, note to be taken, if any discomfort or irritation, discontinue the use of eye drop. And ophthalmic gels, they are for topical application in the eye. Okay, this will be the labeling for these formulations. Moving to question number 11. Roll tube technique is the modification of option A, pour plate technique, option B, streak technique, option C, micro manipulator technique, and option D, spread plate technique. So roll tube techniques is the modification of option B, the streak plate technique. So moving to its explanation, so what is rolling tube technique? So it is the modification of streak plate technique, and here 2 ml of nutrient agar melted, cooled to 50 centigrade with 0.02 milliliter pipette, one drop is added to two tubes. Okay, then tubes are rolled in horizontal position under cold water tap to make uniform agar layer. Then it is incubated and we can count the colonies. Okay, it is called as roll tube technique. Okay, understood? Hope you understood. Moving on to 12th question. movement of charged particles through a liquid under the influence of an applied potential difference is known as option A, sedimentation potential, option B, streaming potential, option C, electrophoresis, and option D, electroosmosis. So, movement of charged particles through liquid under influence of applied potential difference is called as option C, electrophoresis. Moving on to its explanations, so we are going to discuss the other terms. First one is, what is sedimentation potential? Okay, it occurs when dispersed particles moving under the influence of either gravity or centrifugation in a medium. Okay, it is called as sedimentation potential. And second one, streaming potential. Streaming potential, it is the potential difference at zero current produced by the connective flow of charge due to a pressure gradient. Okay, the important term here is due to pressure gradient through a charged capillary, membrane, plug or diaphragm. Okay, it is called as streaming potential. And electroosmosis. What do you mean by electroosmosis? It is the movement or motion of liquid which is adjacent to a flat charged surface under the influence of an electric field. Okay, here what is the term? Under the influence of an electric field. Okay, parallel to the surface. Okay, so these are the definitions for other terms. Moving to 13th question. Here, in pre-formulation study, polymorphs can be detected by option A, countercurrent chromatography, option B, refractometry, option C, HPLC, which is high performance liquid chromatography, and option D, differential scanning. Here the correct answer is which one? Option D, differential scanning. So moving to its explanation, countercurrent method, which is used for particle size and shape determination, refractometry, which is used for the identification of crystal structure, and HPLC, used to ensure the purity and to find out the concentration of the formulation. Okay, these are the explanation. And moving to 14th question, in tablets, hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, which is HPMC, is used as option A, diluent, option B, film former, option C, disintegrant, and option D, binder. And the answer is option B, film former. Okay, HPMC used as film former in a tablet. So in a tablet, other ingredients are also used. You know that some excipients are also used. First one is diluent. The diluent is needed to increase the bulk. Okay, when the quantity of the medicament is very small in each tablet, we are using diluents. Examples include lactose, sucrose, sodium chloride, dextrose, and starch. And second one is film former. They are used to form the film to the tablet. Example, ethyl cellulose. Next one, disintegrant. They are added to a tablet formulation to facilitate its breaking or disintegration when it contact with water in the GIT. Examples include starch 5-20%, primogel, and explotab. And what you mean by binder? They provide strength to the granules to keep the tablet intact. And selection is depends on the type of tablet. Examples include gum tragacanth, methyl cellulose, etc. Okay, this is about the excipients. Moving on to next question. Following are the endogenous carriers used for the targeted drug delivery except option A, lipoproteins, option B, serum albumin, option C, erythrocyte, option D, microparticulates. Okay, we have to find out which is the endogenous carrier
used for the targeted delivery except. Okay, here erythrocyte is not used, so the answer is option C, erythrocyte. So moving to its explanation. Okay, based on the origin, there are two type of carriers. Okay, which are they? Endogenous and exogenous carriers. Okay, endogenous include low density lipoprotein, high density lipoprotein, chylomicrons, serum albumin and erythrocytes. And in case of exogenous, which are they? Microparticulates, soluble polymeric, biodegradable polymeric drug carriers. Okay, these are the some of the examples. Moving on to next question, question number 16. The friability issue of a tablet can be solved by different ways except option A, increasing the upper punch pressure of the tablet machine, option B, addition of more tablet binder to the granules, option C, increasing the moisture content of the granules, and option D, adjusting the lower punch pressure of the tablet machine. Here the correct answer is option B, addition of more tablet binder to the granules. Moving on to its explanation, capping, it is due to the entrapment in the granular material, and lamination, it is the separation of tablet layers into layers, and finally cracking, it is due to the rapid expansion of tablets when deep concave punches are used. Okay, these are the some of the other problems in tablet manufacturing. Moving on to next question, buffer capacity is also referred to as option A, buffer index, option B, buffer value, option C, buffer efficiency, and option D, all of the above. So what do you mean by buffer capacity? So the answer is option A, buffer index, and we have to discuss what is buffer capacity. So buffer capacity is defined as the amount of acid or base that you can add without changing the pH by more than 1 pH unit. Okay, it is called as buffer capacity. Moving on to next question. Suspensions of starch in water exhibit option A, plastic flow, option B, pseudoplastic flow, option C, dilatant flow, option D, none of the above. And here the answer is option A, plastic flow. So we have to discuss what you mean by plastic flow. Plastic flow, it is an increase in stress which leads to non-linear increase in the shear rate, but after that curve is linear. Okay, it is called plastic flow. Then pseudoplastic flow, with an increase in the shearing stress, the disarranged molecules orient themselves in the direction of flow. Okay, thus it reducing friction and allows a greater rate of shear at each shearing stress. It is called as pseudoplastic flow. Next one, dilatant flow. Certain suspensions with high percentage of dispersed solids show an increase in resistance to flow with increasing rate of shear. Okay, such a system increase in volume when sheared, such system is called dilatant flow system, and it also called as shear thickening system. Okay, don't forget that dilatant flow system, also called as shear thickening system. Next question, by addition of which of the following the cells of soft gelatin may be made elastic? Option A, polyethylene glycol, option B, sorbitol, option C, polyethylene glycol, propylene glycol, and option D, dibutyl phthalate. Here the answer is sorbitol. Okay, sorbitol is added to the capsule to made it elastic. Moving to its explanation, PEG, that is polyethylene glycol, which accelerates the dissolution of dissolved or suspended drugs, propylene glycol, which is a non-ionic surface active agent, and dibutyl phthalate, it is a plasticizer used in nail products. Okay, so moving to 20th question, what is primogel? Option A, substituted HPMC for direct compression. Option B, modified microcrystalline cellulose for direct compression. Option C, hydrogelling polymer for gel formation. And option D, modified starch for disintegration. And here the primogel, the answer is, which is a modified starch for disintegration. So here we have to discuss another important term, which is super disintegrants. Okay, super disintegrants, they swells up to 10 folds within 30 seconds. Okay, when it contact with water. Okay, why we are discussing this primogel, which is used for disintegration, right? So we have to discuss about super disintegrants also. They swells up to 10 folds within 30 seconds. Okay, when contact with water. And some of the examples for super disintegrants include cross carmelose, cross linked cellulose, sodium starch glycolate, cross linked starch. Okay, these are the some of the super disintegrants used in our preparations. Thank you for listening by Team Pharma Trios. Hope the video is useful for your further studies. Thank you once again.